So who saw this coming? John Sherman's wife upstaging her husband, Marny Sherman, saying more than any elected leader about what happens next in the stadium saga. Plus, safety on the Plaza back in the headlines after a spray of bullets rips through store windows as shoppers just watch. Those stories and the rest of the week's news straight ahead.
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of AARP Kansas City, RSM, Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gourley, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize, and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees, the Restaurant at 1900, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hello and welcome. I'm Nick Haines. Glad to have you with us on our weekly journey through the week's most impactful, confusing and befuddling local news stories. Jumping on board our Week in Review bus this week, she is 50% of Dana and Parks on KMBZ Radio, Dana Wright. Brian Ellison tracks the region's top political stories for KCUR News. Micheal Mahoney is Channel 9's chief political analyst. And from the helm of our Metro's newest newspaper, Next Page KC, Eric Wesson. A week after voters overwhelmingly rejected the stadium tax, are we any closer to understanding what happens now? It's been kind of fascinating. Those closest to the decision aren't talking. John Sherman says he's still taking time to reflect, and our elected leaders aren't saying much. Jackson County Executive Frank White declined to appear on the program. Perhaps the only person saying anything publicly is John Sherman's wife, Marny. In a surprise and unguarded moment, she upstages her husband by taking to Facebook to declare neither team will work with Jackson County again. So who is Marny Sherman?
We're just normal people. I mean, I grew up at 33rd in the Southwest Traffic Way. John had a similar upbringing. We just feel like we're normal people.
Dana, I have to say, I have to think to go back to the time of Mark Funkhauser as mayor of Kansas City,
yeah,
when Gloria Squitiro, his wife, was such a major player.
Sure.
Have I heard a spouse taking such a pivotal role in some sort of debate on a big public policy issue in Kansas
City? I think
City.
Mrs. Sherman wears shoes, and if that's normal, I want to be normal, by the way. It was surprising to see, and I love that she has a voice. Obviously, she's part of that decision-making process. That was a shocking statement and a blunt statement. And I will tell you, everywhere I go, it is the number one question people ask me in the grocery store, certainly on the show, that doesn't involve a goat stuck up somewhere. The number one question people ask is, where are the Royals going? What is happening to the Chiefs? That did not help the chatter that someone might be crossing state line and moving over
to Kansas. What did you make of it, Michael?
I thought it was very interesting. I don't know for a fact that she speaks for her husband or for the Royals. And the other thing is, what you said off the top here, that people are not talking out publicly about this. That suggests to me that they are talking quietly behind the scenes on this stuff.
You know, I don't know that we should read a whole lot in. Those comments were made just a day or two after the election. It is the kind of thing where there's a response happening there that's not entirely strategic or corporate. Having said that, I think it does reflect the personal mindset of the Sherman household. And I have to say, we haven't talked much about this, Nick, but kind of who can blame them? The way the Shermans were described and treated over the course of this campaign, it became very personal.
Yeah.
Language that referred to them as sort of billionaire predators that was used by the campaign against, and then picked up in a lot of mainstream media outlets. You know, the Shermans have given millions upon millions of dollars to arts and education and cultural organizations in Kansas City. I think they were just shocked at the way they were treated, and I think those comments, quite understandably, really, reflect that reaction more than they reflect real predictors of what the Royals are going to do next.
Yeah, I don't think anybody was surprised that that issue went down to defeat. I don't think anybody, no one I have talked to, expected a 16-point drubbing.
But it's interesting we're talking about saying we're never going to work with Jackson County again. The teams have only been working with Jackson County with those lease agreements. Even Dave Helling, I think, last week said they could negotiate the teams directly with City Hall. Would that create a new political civil war in this community? Won't Jackson County legislators, Frank White, for instance, you know, then start filing lawsuits and putting every roadblock in place to stop the teams from negotiating directly with City Hall?
He could do that. But let me say this. The teams aren't really warm and fuzzy about Mayor Lucas either. Even though he said he had a good conversation with John Sherman, That was a very brief conversation, is my understanding. He said, hey, if you got an idea, put it on paper and send it to us. But their issue with him was that he came out extremely late in the campaign. People were already early voting, and he endorses the campaign 2 days before the election. And it was his idea to move it from the area that they were at in East Village over to Crossroads. So they're not real warm and fuzzy with him either.
We put Michael Mahoney on the spot on this on our show and asked, if you had to put a percentage to it, do the Chiefs jump to Kansas? And this gets back to her comments, whether they were, you know, done without a lot of, you know, thought or not. Do they jump? And you said 50-50. You said you thought it was 50-50.
I said I thought it was less than 50-50.
But this right is now, this right has been now. An awful lot of rumor, speculation that Kansas would steal one or both of these teams. Yet, has there been any deal put on the table? I mean, has there been any movement on that?
No, but I talked with a number of people, a couple of people very close to what's taking place in Kansas here. And Kansas is in the process of assembling a plan to go after, probably, quite likely, the Chiefs for Western Wyandotte County. And it is possible that when the legislature comes back for their veto session in a couple of weeks, that there may be some efforts to tweak the star bonds in Kansas, which is going to be one of their chief financing vehicles for this, to allow them to do this. And the folks I'm talking to say, look, between the $4 million that are in the sports book fund, which is not a lot, that the state of Kansas has plenty of other money that they put on the table, and it does not require a public vote of any sort for the state of Kansas to make a play.
Okay, I love the reporters we have around this table, but as everyone seems to be fixated, as Michael's talking about there, on Wyandotte County as a possible site, I thought it would be interesting to bring on Wyandotte County Mayor Tyrone Garner on the program, but he is still missing from the mayor's office, having taken a leave of absence for an undisclosed medical procedure at the beginning of February. A staffer told us he's not expected back until May. We also invited Jackson County Executive Frank White to join us. He respectfully declined, but he acknowledged this week he has not spoken to the team since the election, and they've not reached out to him.
My goal is to reach out to the teams and see if I can get them back to the table so we can try to move this thing forward.
Have you reached out to them?
Not to this point. And they haven't reached out to me at this point. It's only been a few days.
But, I mean, is there a strategy, though, to keep them here? That's what I think my goal is.
I have a strategy, but I'm not willing to share it at this point.
Now, that's kind of cryptic. Prior to Election Day, White said he would push to put a separate tax on the ballot this August just for the Chiefs. Is that still the plan?
We don't know the plan. It sounds like the plan
he
is...
He knows what the plan is. He just said so. He's just not sharing it with you.
Indeed. He has not told me. I think it is not really a surprise that the Royals in particular have not reached out to Frank White. It's going to be a while before those are easy conversations. But I do think the momentum is growing for a focus on the Chiefs separately from the Royals, and I think you will see more conversation about that in the weeks ahead.
How do you go back to the same people and ask for another vote when they've called you billionaires, they've called you racist, they've called you all these other names? And how do you go back before them and say, hey, everything is hunky-dory?
Voters have short-term attention spans.
Not that short.
The other thing is that the plan that was presented to the Jackson County and Kansas City voters was clumsy, to say the least. It was poorly laid out, and there were lots of questions about it. I think that if they take another bite out of the apple with East Village again, I'm not sure it's going to happen this year, by the way, but if they do take another bite out of the apple, they'll have to have a much better orchestrated campaign than what the voters saw this year.
I didn't happen to notice, by the way, this week, Brian, that Mayor Quinton Lucas was meeting with Mike Parson, the governor. Was that about the stadium tax, trying to get money for a potential new tax election in Kansas City?
They also did not disclose their agenda to me in conversation, but they did. But it wouldn't surprise me if it came up. Governor Parson had said beforehand that they would be willing to talk about the Royals stadium after the election. Obviously, the election results did not move that conversation forward, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's not on the back burner. Governor Parson has been very supportive of the Royals as one of the state's baseball
teams. Really quick, let's go back to Frank White for a second. They can't swing and miss it this twice. That answer was clumsy. Yeah. He was unprepared. They needed to have a statement ready to go that we are sorry, we screwed this up, we need to do better. We are going to come out with a plan that makes sense for everybody. And that's not what we just heard. We just heard, I don't like them. They don't like me. I've not reached out to them. They haven't reached out to me. And by the way, I do have a plan, but I'm not going to tell you what it is. Voters are not going to go for that. I think the Chiefs go to Kansas and we get a roof.
And one other thing, there's a word that voters use that leaves a bitter taste in everybody's mouth in Jackson County. It's assessments.
Yep,
and I think
absolutely.
Those assessments are going to be an issue throughout, whether you bring it back to a vote before the people or not.
Go on.
I want to say I don't think the conversation with the Royals about staying in Kansas City or Jackson County or somewhere else in the metro is over. I agree with my friends here that this is not going to happen in the next few months. The bitter taste in voters' mouths needs a little time to dissipate. But I think there still are options for the Royals, and I think they'll be pursuing them quietly for a while.
I did see that Dick Davis, the former head of the KCATA, the transit service in Kansas City, did write a big column this week in the Star that said about putting a roof on a stadium, as you just mentioned that, yeah. Dana, but actually in the current position of where the Kauffman Stadium is right now, that if it is such a problem for them, build a new stadium there with a roof.
So the roof, as we know, did not pass the first time they put that in front of voters, but I think voters have a much better understanding of the global importance of using that space 365 days a year, where you could have concerts, you could have a Final Four, you could have a women's Final Four, you could have a Super Bowl, and the roof would provide all of those things.
And quickly, don't forget, Clay County is out there, and their bid for Northtown is still now back in play.
Now that the stadium tax election is over, have you noticed how the Royals have come alive? The team was basking in a winning streak this week, having just secured their first sweep of a four-game series since 2021. If the Royals' bats had come alive a little earlier, might it have made a difference on the election day outcome, Dana?
No, not the way it was presented to voters. I don't think the way that clumsily was presented to voters, it would have mattered.
No, I agree. If they had a 500 year last year rather than 106 losses, it might have had an impact, but not this early in the baseball season.
Now, we can't mention the Royals' latest success without mentioning Dana Wright throughout the first, by the way, yeah, she threw out the first pitch during that winning sweep of the White Sox.
I got it over the plate.
You are
That's
a newsmaker.
All I'm gonna say.
You are a newsmaker.
I got it over the plate. I have never been so nervous. And let me just tell you, it is a lot further than it looks when you're standing
okay.
out there.
Eric, is it your turn this week?
I'm ready. They got my phone number. Just give me a holler. I can make it reach to the home plate, though.
Now, safety on the Plaza was back in the spotlight this week as a spray of bullets takes out a window at Shake Shack and damages vehicles while stunned shoppers watched.
I can get why, you know, people would feel unsettled coming down here. It's unfortunate.
It's kind of sad that violence is happening like that, especially on the Plaza, and it was not late at night or anything. It was still light outside.
How has safety and security changed, if at all, since the last shooting on the Plaza hit the news back in September, when a store manager was shot along with a 14-year-old boy?
Nothing. There was some chatter about...
We were told there was going to be park police be brought in by Mayor Quinton Lucas to help support existing police on the Plaza.
Uh-huh. We've told that you could buy a piece of the Golden Gate Bridge as well, but it hasn't happened. In this particular case, and my editorial this week is on parenting, parents need to watch their kids. I watched a video of a parent going off on somebody on Facebook Live about videotaping their kid. But wait a minute, your kid is out here on the Plaza acting a fool, and you're mad at somebody for recording it. Why aren't you out there with your kid?
The police presence is reactive. We need to do something proactive. Reactive is after the shots have been fired, and I will remind you, shots were fired into cars. One of those cars was occupied, and Yael Albahalka, formerly of the Kansas City Star, rightly either tweeted or Facebooked about this. That is the third shooting in or around Shake Shack, where
right.
large groups of unsupervised kids are gathering, some of them with clearly illegal guns. They have to get their arms around this. I am a huge proponent of pedestrianizing the Plaza, shut down the streets, plant trees, make it a grassy space, and make it an entertainment district where kids do not belong after 9 p.m.
But a lot of the kids were there for prom.
You think so?
I do.
A lot of kids were there for prom. So they were there legitimately and had a reason to be there.
If you're wearing a tuxedo, there's an exception.
Yeah.
Do you remember back in October on the show, we were talking about the Plaza was going to be bought. A company from Dallas that had high upscale shopping centers in Texas was going to come in, swoop in and buy the Plaza. That deal now, you know, 6 months later has still not been signed. I mean, have they got cold feet now?
I don't think we know. You're right. It still seems to be on the table, but it hasn't closed. I mean, I think the ongoing conversation, and this is almost becoming cliche to say this, but I'll say it anyway, let's remember that shootings happen every day in other parts of the city so often that we don't talk about them. It's because this happened at the Plaza that we're having this conversation at all. Let's not forget that the problem of violence in the city is not because it occurs in a shopping district. It's the sheer quantity
of lives. But for the third time in the same spot. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think it's very significant. It's a high-profile area of town, but our, even if we eliminated all crime on the Plaza, we would still have a record number of people
dying.
It's
interesting you say that, because when we had the parade shooting and we lost a woman, a Johnson County mother, in that whole shooting after the rally when the Chiefs had the victory rally, that was the 17th murder of the year. Now we're at 40. There have been 23 murders since then.
Yes. And no end in sight, no plan, no real clear plan on how things are going to go. I noticed they put $7 million in the budget this year for violence prevention. $6 million of it was already accounted for with something that they passed last session. So this time they got an extra $1 million. Where they're going to put that money at is beyond people to know, but you're going to have to do something.
We're marking two anniversaries this week that put Kansas City in the national news spotlight, and for all the wrong reasons. First, it is 1 year since the Ralph Yarl shooting. Remember him? He's the black teen who was shot in the head after ringing a wrong doorbell in Kansas City's Northland. 85-year-old Andrew Lester pleaded not guilty in the case. His trial won't begin until October. And 10 years ago this week, a lone gunman on a quest to exterminate Jews killed three people outside the Jewish Community Center in Village Shalom in Overland Park. All the targeted victims would turn out to be Christian. Fraser Glenn Cross was convicted of capital murder and sentenced to death, but he would die in prison in 2021. This is more than a national story, Dana. This was an international one when it happened 10 years ago.
It was, sadly, and Mindy Corporon's become a very good friend of mine. She lost her father, lost her son, Reet, that day, and I was able to attend the 7 days breakfast this week, where her entire focus in that last 10 years has been, you know, we don't say the shooter's name. We're not going to look backward. We're going to look forward to see how we can all somehow, starting when kids are younger, work on conflict resolution, work on peace and love, regardless of your race or your age or your gender or your religion. She's done amazing things. 22 different school districts now have ambassadors, kindness ambassadors in our schools, to help people, you know, sit with the kid who's sitting alone at the lunch table, so that hopefully that, to me, is preventative. When you say you're gonna throw $8 million to prevent gun violence, I don't know what that means. We have to start with our young people and teach them that there's a better way.
And it has to start at home with the quality of life that young people are living. Even though we say that they're having conflicts with individuals at school, sometimes those conflicts are at home. And you have to be able to look at the environment that the kids are in, the neighborhoods, and the things that are acceptable for those type of behaviors. And I think that's what the missing piece of the puzzle is.
That's a good point. Yet, the number of hate crimes in this country has, I'll use the word, exploded in the last few years, and we're seeing it right now.
Dana mentions the kindness word, and there is a kindness festival at the Jewish Community Center this Sunday at 4:30 p.m. And by the way, we've just done a new documentary about the 10th anniversary of the Jewish Community Center shootings. It's called Healing Hate. You can see it after the rebroadcast of this program. Week in Review is on Sunday at 11. Healing Hate will start at 11:30. So is it worse than we thought? For a second straight week, many critical Jackson County offices remain closed as the county scrambles to recover from a ransomware attack that was first reported on Election Day. Now we're informed those offices could remain closed through next Tuesday. We were told bad actors had apparently taken over the county's computer systems, shutting down the assessment, tax collection, and recorder of deeds offices, and impacting everything from marriage licenses to county jail records. And guess who the county is now blaming?
It was a Russian group. They have done this fairly frequently around the country. They're a frequent player in this kind of activity. So it's a question of when, not if, you're going to hit. You're going to have one of these cyber attacks.
County Administrator Troy Schulte there. So now we know it was the Russians. What are we to make of that?
First of all, could Jackson County be having any worse
right.
of a month?
Yeah, really.
On top of it, all the Russians have broken into our computers. This does happen to me.
I do have a degree in Soviet politics, by the way, so I'm going to remove myself from the rest of this conversation.
Thank you for disclosing your conflict of interest. The reality is that this does happen to municipalities, to hospitals, to organizations all over the country.
KCPT just had it happen
So Jackson County probably isn't being singled out and didn't do something wrong, but it still is a massive pain, and it couldn't come at a worse time.
They'll pay it. Let's be clear. They will pay it.
They will pay something.
The hackers make it just affordable enough that these towns and hospitals and cities will pay it. The insurance.
That's what I also wanted to ask, by the way, to Wyandotte County, because they had the same issue there. Did they pay
you
millions
have to pay
in Wyandotte County?
We had one municipality pay half, and you know what the Russians did? They gave them half the code back to unlock their stuff. The ransomware insurance industry is now a multi-billion-dollar industry because of this.
And by the way, you know, we laugh a little bit about it. However, it is impacting a lot of services, including now house sales. Some people are having struggling to even buy a house in Jackson County.
Right, because they have to get documents through the courthouse. And they can't get those.
If you're one of the tens of thousands of metro area residents still holding out hope of getting your college debt forgiven, President Biden had a big announcement this week. He unveiled a new plan to reduce or cancel your college loan payments. And guess who was on Capitol Hill this week to testify in favor of the plan? None other than Mayor Quinton Lucas. It was a split-screen moment because just a few miles away, the Missouri Attorney General was leading a multi-state effort to kill the proposal in court.
And cancellation of student debt would be the single largest investment in America's working people that we can today, with real benefits for everyone.
At the end of the day, this harms Missourians, and we can't let Joe Biden saddle working Missouri families with Ivy League debt.
All righty, Brian, why was it two elected leaders from here leading the charge for and against the president's plan this week? Do we have more college debt here in our metropolitan area than any other place in the country? Is that the deal?
We do not. None of this has anything to do with Missouri, at least not Missouri specifically. Certainly the mayor has regularly appeared in sort of support of national democratic causes. But the attorney general, Andrew Bailey, is clearly advocating for things, along with a lot of other Republicans attorney general that are Republican attorneys general who are not necessarily advocating because that is their issue, but because it is an opportunity to take a shot at the Biden administration, and it doesn't help them, it doesn't hurt them politically back home here in Missouri.
And Andrew Bailey, of course, is running for election this year.
Primary.
Chris Kobach, by the way, in Kansas, the attorney general there, also saying this is illegal. I can see why there's a political dimension there, but why Quinton Lucas, with all of the other issues on his plate, when he's dealing with a stadium tax, they're still trying to solve that problem, plus crime issues, that he's got time to go off to Washington, D.C. to be involved in this issue?
For the reasons that Brian talked about, is he has frequently stepped up to the plate and defended or advocated Biden administration policies. In the case of Andrew Bailey, he has a very tough primary coming up against a well-funded opponent, and so it is in his best interest and his campaign's best interest, they believe, to be out front. In this case, the state of Missouri is one of five or six different states that are the plaintiffs in this lawsuit challenging this. He's got political skin in the game.
And Mayor Quinton Lucas is not there because he fancies himself as the next education secretary if Joe Biden is going to get another 4 years in office?
He might. He might be there. He might be HUD. HUD has an opening, and he can promote the situation that they had with Parade Park and some of the homeless things that he takes credit for with his administration.
I would just say you can't have a conversation about erasing college debt, which is the next bubble that's going to burst. It's worse than the combined credit card debt in America, without having a conversation about the exploding cost of education that is out of reach for so many. And there was an article this week, I think I read, that at some point the average cost is going to be $100,000 a year. It's not affordable. We have to have that conversation
But less than half the country has a four-year college degree.
Yeah.
My view is why this debt versus, say, medical debt, crippling.
It's a fair question.
And is also exploding at great rates. When you put a program like this together every week, you can't get to every story grabbing the headlines. What was the big local story we missed? It was a week in which we all put on funny glasses and stared at the sky.
This is just like the coolest experience I've ever experienced. This is blowing my mind. It is so cool.
No clemency granted, Missouri carries out its first execution of the year. Remember that Jackie Robinson statue stolen from a Wichita park? Now what's left of it arriving this week at its new home, the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. Kansas City gets messy as global soccer superstar Lionel Messi arrives in town for an Arrowhead Stadium showdown between Miami and Sporting KC. Fans gobbled up the tickets, but there were worries all week about whether he'd play. And how often does a goat top the headlines, and how did it even get up there? The big goat bridge rescue goes viral this week. All right. sorry, Dana. Did you pick one of those stories or something completely
it's
different?
It's the goat. I'm sorry. Okay. And by the way, the goat's name is Jeffrey. They're trying to name it something else. It's Jeffrey. Everywhere I went, people asked me about the goat. People needed a fun distraction this week. On Twitter, they were like, how's the goat? Have we gotten the goat down? I mean, hats off to KCFD. I don't know how they figured it out. They did get the goat down. We need that type of fun thing in our news cycle. Jeffrey, thank you for providing it.
Eric.
I said the state taking over the St. Louis Police Department again. They're pushing forth that effort. They think they can do a better job, even though St. Louis homicide rate is down and things seem to be leveled out. They think they can do a better job. And the referendum movement to reverse the contract that was given to city manager Brian Platt.
It's the eclipse. I remember 7 years ago, I was in St. Joe on a very overcast day, and we couldn't see squat. This time, from the luxury penthouse in my backyard, I was actually able to see, you know, the 90% eclipse this time.
We really need to see pictures of you in those glasses, though, so we'll be looking to add that to the program. Brian.
Just when you thought abortion rights in Missouri couldn't be any less of an issue this week, the Missouri General Assembly sent a proposal to defund Planned Parenthood from providing any other sorts of services, as well as continued its conversation about initiative petition reform, which might result in ballot measures that would restore abortion rights in Missouri not being able to get a passing vote. So there's a lot still ahead in the few weeks that are left of the Missouri legislature.
And Kansas lawmakers taking a break right now before they have a veto session at the end of the month. And on that, we will say our week has been reviewed. Courtesy of Dana Wright, 50% of Dana and Parks, 2 to 6. Weekdays on KMBZ and Channel 9 political analyst Micheal Mahoney. From Next Page KC, Eric Wesson. And from KCUR News, Brian Ellison. And I'm Nick Haines. From all of us here at Kansas City PBS, be well, keep calm, and carry on.